We're joining you from the Bajaj Auto plant in Akurdi, Pune. The company has launched its biggest Pulsar yet, the NS400Z. This iconic motorcycle for the brand was launched way back in 2001. They've sold more than 1.8 crore motorcycles of the Pulsar brand alone. Now, what does the Z in NS400Z really imply about the future? The company is definitely targeting the premium portfolio in a big way. They want to go for CNG, alternate fuel, and electric vehicles as well. To speak about the company's strategy and this milestone is none other than the Managing Director of Bajaj Auto, Rajeev Bajaj. Mr. Bajaj, thank you very much for speaking to CNBC TV 18.
Thank you.
You said this is a milestone for the company. Why is it a milestone and what does this really signify about the brand going forward?
Well, for many reasons, Parikshit, you know, I would say, first of all, in 2001, when Pulsar was launched, it really heralded sports motorcycle cycling into a country which was obsessed with fuel economy. You know, so this shift in culture to sports motorcycles started with the Pulsar. Then the whole transition of Bajaj from Hamara Bajaj to becoming the world's favorite Indian, the Indian motorcycle company that is today present across 90 countries. You know, this has been spearheaded by the Pulsar brand and by all the products that it represents. And you know, finally, I would say, as they say, for a sports person, you're only as good as your last game, or an actor is only as good as the last movie. You know, in some ways, a brand is only as good as its last product. And with motorcycles, we have a saying in this industry that there is no replacement for displacement. You know, that everything matters. But bigger is always better. So we thought it was the right time, you know, with almost 20 million Pulsar maniacs across the world, for us to launch the biggest Pulsar ever, and in the process to also reposition, if I may say, the Pulsar from definitely male to definitely daring, because, and we have to thank Ogilvy and Piyush Pandey for this, because, you know, I think that really captures the spirit of the brand like nothing else.
Awesome. We also like to ask you about how much did you spend on developing this 400cc motorcycle, a 373cc engine, but you're positioning this in your 400cc lineup.
Right. Well, actually, you know, we have a platform approach, you know, so which means that fundamentally major aggregates like the engine, transmission, frame, etc., will often be similar at a certain level for multiple brands and definitely for multiple products. So in that sense, the investment is not very high. It's not a secret, so I'm not being shy of sharing it with you. I simply don't know exactly whether it's 40 crores or 60 crores or 80 crores. But I can only say this, for a company that has almost 20,000 crores on its books and that last year finished with a PAT of 7,500 crores, investment is not a problem, especially for a brand like Pulsar.
Definitely. I would also like to ask you, have you taken certain risks with the 400cc Pulsar in any way?
You know, contra-intuitively, Parikshit, I would say that the only or the biggest risk we may have taken is we may perhaps be a little later than we should have been. You know, what I mean is that sometimes brands get trapped in their success. You know, you become very successful. And then, I mean, I wouldn't want to name such brands for obvious reasons, but then you want to be safe. And by that, what I mean is that the product has basically three dimensions to it: how it looks, the design, the performance, how it feels, and the price, you know. And unless you move at least on one of these axes, the brand becomes stagnant. So I think the biggest risk you run with a brand like this, especially which is a motorcycle brand and a sports motorcycle brand, is for it to be stagnant for too long. You know? Of course, on the other hand, you can't do too much with it, because then it won't be a Pulsar. Either it won't look like one, or it won't feel like one, or it'll be too expensive to be one. So you don't want to make that mistake either. So as a company, we have our own way of how, as much as possible, in a very quantified way, we define the evolution of our brands and products, so that we don't do too much and we don't do too little. But in this case, maybe we could have done a little more a little before.
So maybe the Pulsar 400 could have come 3 years earlier, maybe, into the market.
Maybe.
All right. You have five motorcycles now in the 400cc segment. You've got the Triumph Twins, you've got the Dominar, you've got the 390 KTM, and now the Pulsar 400. How do you expect to increase your sales and market share in the middleweight motorcycle segment as you've often said, is the most juicy, most lucrative pie right now.
Right, yeah, this is the most lucrative motorcycle segment in the world, I would say. Our thinking is very simple, that you always have to be in the top three of any segment, preferably in the top two, if not the leader. You know, so today, again, as a global company, I would say that if I put together our volumes, average monthly volumes, of all the brands that you mentioned, we are probably in the ballpark of 25, 30,000 motorcycles a month, which is not a small volume in this space. Obviously, with this NS400Z, we hope to take it much further, both in the domestic and the export markets. So I would like to think that in 6 months' time, we should be closer to 35,000 motorcycles a month, which then brings us, if I may say, at about half the level at which the market leader, namely Enfield, is at. So I think when you are a very strong number two at that level, that's a good position to be at. So in a practical way, I would say that that would be our short-term target with this. Then how we can take it further from there, of course, we have to see over time.
So you're trying to work from a 20 to 25% market share to a 50% market share in how many months?
50% of Royal Enfield, which would be about 35% or so of the market, maybe a little more. Hopefully in 6 months' time, it will take that much time to rev up production for this particular motorcycle. And at the same time, you know, we are fortunate the new KTM portfolio has been very well received, both here and in overseas markets. The Triumphs have got off to a great start, and there's some more action coming on that front very soon. Mm-hmm. The Dominar continues to hold its own. So it's looking good.
Right. The capacity in terms of all these five motorcycles put together, what would that be and how much would you like to take it to in the next 6 to 8 months?
Currently, it's at about 40,000 a month. These motorcycles are all, especially the partnership brands, as I call them, KTM and Triumph, are all made in a new plant that we set up in Chakan last year. So we have a capacity there that's exclusive for them. Whereas the bigger Pulsars and Dominars are made at our older Chakan plant. Between the two, our capacity is 40,000 a month, roughly 500,000 a year. As we begin to approach this capacity in 6 months' time, then we will review the need to expand.
All right. Now, motorcycle enthusiasts have always been asking you to build bigger bikes. So what's your message to them? Will there be a bigger Pulsar after this? You have titled the motorcycle or named this as the NS400Z. Z signifies something in the future. Will there be a bigger displacement Pulsar coming, or is this the end of the series, so to say?
You know, Helmut Kohl said the biggest room in the world is the room for improvement. So this I can guarantee, that there will always be a better Pulsar. Very often than not, it means a bigger Pulsar, you know. But there is still a lot of technology that we can bring to bear on the Pulsar without it necessarily becoming bigger. For example, what if the Pulsar were to remain, as someone asked me today, a 400cc Pulsar, but were to become a twin-cylinder Pulsar? You know, I think that would again move the needle very significantly forward, because the feel and sound of a twin-cylinder sewing machine of a motorcycle is very different from a single-cylinder motorcycle. But the important thing, as I said earlier, is that every brand has a position in the marketplace. You know, we cannot risk doing too little, but we cannot also risk doing too much, because we have to have the humility to accept that people are not going to pay for a Pulsar what they pay for a KTM or a Triumph. You know, it is very easy for the engineer in us to make a motorcycle that is completely on par with KTM and Triumph, if not even better. But then, you know, making it is easy, but selling it would be a problem. So while we endow Pulsar with the best of technology, I mean, today this Pulsar is as feature-rich and as performance-rich as its KTM sibling. But we have to engineer it at the same time to be much more affordable, as you saw from the pricing of 1.85 lakhs, which is a very profitable price for us. So it is when you get all these three aspects, design, performance, and cost or price, right, that the magic happens, when you align the front and the back end perfectly like that. You know? And that has always been our endeavor. So yes, there will always be a better Pulsar. There may well be a bigger Pulsar, but for sure, Pulsar will keep moving forward.
All right, Pulsar will keep going forward. But give us, our viewers, some insight into your portfolio for this year. In your launch event, you hinted at a lot of things. An exciting new Dominar, something new on the Triumph space. What can we expect in terms of launches? CNG is the big launch coming up, clearly. next month. But in terms of the premium portfolio, the commuter bike portfolio, the Chetak portfolio, how many products can we look at?
So, Parikshit, at this time, we are seized by work in three directions. One is in the commuter motorcycle space, commuter two-wheeler space. There, as you already mentioned, the really big one is going to be the CNG motorcycle. I can say to you that it is due next month. We are almost production ready. The first CNG motorcycle in the world, and a motorcycle that halves the running cost as compared to its petrol bike. So I think that's a fantastic innovation. At the same time, for those who prefer a scooter, as you know, the Chetak has been growing strongly over the last 1 year. I think this time last year we were at 3,000 Chetaks a month. We are now at almost four times that number. And we are about to launch yet another Chetak this month. So our Chetak portfolio will be three scooters. And as I said to you, as I shared with you some time back, there will always be at least one new Chetak every year. So something later this year and for sure next year, we have something distinctly different. It's not just another refresh on the existing Chetak, but a new platform itself. Mm-hmm. So Chetak will get both smaller and smaller and smaller. And Chetak will also get bigger, and Chetak may well get three wheels, and Chetak may well get four wheels. Between design, performance, and cost, how do we take this brand ahead? So I think we are going to have a really very, very potent Chetak portfolio over the coming years. On the sports motorcycle front, we'll continue to move forward with the Pulsar, as we've discussed, and the Dominar. At the same time, we've just done a lot of work on the KTMs and Triumphs. And as I said to you, there will be at least one more Triumph to be introduced later this year. And there are several in development. Nick doesn't like me to say too much too soon, so I'm going to stop at that. But there are several bikes in development between Triumph and myself, ourselves. And finally, on the three-wheeler portfolio, because that's the third very, very important area of work for Bajaj. We are the world's number one three-wheeler maker. We have 80% of this market. So again, it's almost as if it's our responsibility to move that ahead. So we've done that with the CNG. There will be more action on that front on the CNG three-wheeler. We've started with the e-auto also the e-cargo more recently. We've gained a lot of momentum. I can say to you that markets in which we have been there for over 3 months or 4 months, I think without exception, we are a market leader already in the e-three-wheeler space in those markets. And since I always feel obliged to share something new with you, I will do so by saying that as much as there is a large market for e-autos in this country, I would say about 50, 60,000 a month, there is an equally large market that we don't address, which is called e-rickshaw, because it has typically been characterized by a lot of cheap products made out of imported kits that don't meet any safety norms and are really quite unsafe on the road. So we have been asking ourselves that as the world's largest three-wheeler maker, should we not be looking at this space, not only because it's at least in volume terms as big as this space, so it makes a lot of business sense, but just so that the whole image of anything on three wheels, is taken to a certain minimum level, at least. So I think this is a very interesting opportunity for us. So who knows, today Bajaj is not part of that space, but we may have something to show.
So when could that come?
Very soon.
Very soon, within this fiscal.
I'm not going to say anything that specific, but we are going to work very hard to get it out as soon as we can.
The CNG motorcycle is going to be extremely important for Bajaj, as you've said a couple of times. What kind of capacity allocation are you looking for, and how much are you really investing in terms of building this CNG portfolio?
So again, capacity is quite flexible, but we are being a little cautious here because, it is such a new animal, so to speak. So we start with a capacity of 20,000 a month, which is really quite minuscule because in our view, this motorcycle in the Indian market alone addresses a space of almost 600,000 motorcycles a month.
There's no major change that is required in terms of where you fuel up your vehicle. You can just go to the conventional station. And if this works, will you consider like a CNG motorcycle every year?
Oh, yeah. we already have that on the plan. Once again, it's a platform. So if I'm not wrong, there's at least five or six motorcycles of the same platform under development. What we launch in June will be just the first one or two. And then if the response is good, we will again make it bigger, make it smaller, make it cheaper, make it more expensive.
Right, and I'm assuming that will be starting entry level.
Absolutely.
Somewhere a little above the entry level, because you know it's always nice to introduce new technology on the back of something that's relatively sexy.
Right.
You know.
And it'll have an all new name.
So it won't be something cheap at 70,000 like you have some of these electric scooters in the marketplace now. But yeah, new brand, completely new.
All right. Any other alternate fuel vehicles that you're working on? Maybe a hydrogen motorcycle, as being speculated in the press?
No, we don't have a product-specific plan with technologies like hydrogen, on technologies like hydrogen. But whether it will first appear on a scooter, in a Chetak, or on a three-wheeler, it's too early to say that yet.
Okay, so you're working on alternate fuel vehicles?
Yes, of course.
But nothing immediate in terms of launch that you're working on?
No.
All right. So how many products in your Chetak portfolio, say, in the next 3 years?
Difficult to say, but in our mind, we see eight. Very clearly. How many of these will actually make it to the marketplace? That time will tell.
So you've said you'll have the smallest vehicle in the Chetak, the middleweight, the higher capacity, and maybe a four-wheeler as well. Are you talking about a car, or are you talking about the cute EV?
That we will discover as we go along.
All right. In terms of the offtake of Chetak, the numbers have started increasing. How much do you plan to take it to in this fiscal?
I think in the last quarter, when we finished the last financial year, we may have clocked about 35,000 units. I do remember our CFO Dinesh saying we did more in the last quarter than we did in all of the previous year. So it's growing dramatically. I would certainly like to think that we can keep that pace of growth, which means, you know, 20, 30, 40%. How much it will be exactly is not entirely up to us. As you know, there was a discontinuity because of FAME. Mm-hmm. So again, April has been a little slow. There's competition to deal with. But yeah, we would like to grow in very, very strong double digits.
Strong double digits. Have your CapEx plans gotten a little uncertain because of the subsidy scenario? It's come down to about 10,000 rupees per scooter. The subsidies may only last now for about 2 years or so. Has that somehow impacted your CapEx plan? Do you feel a little uncertain in terms of how you want to take things, maybe want to wait till elections? How would you allot your CapEx for ICE and EVs now?
Actually, Parikshit, you heard me say this multiple times whenever we've spoken about subsidies, that I am against subsidies. In that sense, we never made our business plans, including our CapEx plans, based on subsidies being available. So there is no question of now changing anything in our plans just because the subsidies are being tapered off. You know, we never relied on them, so we have no withdrawal symptoms, if I may say so. And it's the same to do with elections. You know, as a global company, we cannot keep adjusting our product and market plans based on election here, I mean election somewhere else tomorrow, one event here, one event there. You know, we just have to keep going at the pace that we've decided for ourselves. So nothing changes as far as we are concerned. As I said earlier, we are fortunate, you know, we have a lot of money in the bank, we have some very good people, and that's frankly all we need to keep
going. Any indication that you'd like to give us of a number and the breakup between ICE and EV?
In terms of?
ICE and EV?
Volume?
CapEx allotment?
So I think out of the CapEx for this year, which is a little over 1,000 crores, the highest it's been in recent times, I think more than half is now EV-led. So clearly there's investments also on the ICE front, but more than half is on the EV front.
Right. So Bajaj Auto has a lot of excitement in store for this whole fiscal year, FY25. We're going to take a short break, but don't go anywhere.